Ladies and gentlemen, oh wait, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Canada Cup Season 7, Team Freedom versus the Friendship, Dedication, Love, Lower Bracket Madness matchup. We're here in game number 2. Sayori and Grant back at the helm. FDL up 1-0 over Freedom. They beat Shazam yesterday. That was an upset that left the bettors sad. Tonight, FDL are the heavy favorite, 72%. And so far, they're living up to the hype, Grant. Let's see if they can do it again in game 2.
Yeah, and look at this. Freedom's like, we're not giving FDL Beastmaster. And we assume they can do it. Then they ban out the Phoenix. If you ban out Phoenix and you have first pick, it means you either don't have a Phoenix player or you just don't like playing with it because it's too good of a hero not to pick it when you're first pick. Mm-hmm. And there's the Abaddon first ban again. You're not going to see Ikes might get that in an NA game ever.
Yeah, that is maybe one. I mean, it makes sense because he's not played that often, and it is one of those heroes that is just so hard to deal with. Like a good Abaddon player that knows how aggressive he can be and push it to the limits, you feel like he's just always in your face. You're always being slowed by Curse of Avernus. There's always damage coming your way. It's just an all-around irritating hero that's generally hard to shut down. Even if you zone him out, you know, he can always just go Iron Talon and retreat to the jungle. That's one of the greatest parts about this patch. Hey, you're having a tough time in your lane. Don't worry, buddy. We got this cool item that lets you just destroy those big bad creeps. No problem.
Lion.
Ooh. Now we see the return of Lion. Well, not really the return. I guess he was picked yesterday, and he's picked almost every day.
Did he ever leave?
The first pick, Lion.
Hey, Grant, I learned yesterday that you're supposed to refrigerate Soylent after you open it.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
just
were you drinking
FYI.
It warm?
Yeah, well, I was just opening them, and then, you know, I get distracted, and then I come back the next day, and I'm still hungry. So I just go for the leftover Soylent. I thought it was like, you know, like Chinese food, like pizza. You just let it sit there, and overnight, the next day, it's still good. Apparently, you're supposed to refrigerate it. So just FYI, PSA, you know, keep your Soylent cold.
PSA, Zayori leaves his pizza and Chinese food out in the god counter overnight and eats it. That's what I got from this story. The
really?
Soylent thing, I think any normal person would know that it's a drink. You refrigerate drinks, Andrew. What is wrong with you?
You can leave water out overnight, you know?
Yeah, but it's still like, it's that bubbly stuff and even water tastes bad when you leave it out.
Yeah, you're kind of right, actually. All right, maybe I should stop leaving stuff out overnight. Soylent included.
It's really good. Oh, and the actually, we were just talking about Kingdom Dota and stuff, and Skywrath was their pickup when they had Jaw playing, and looks like Freedom is gonna steal that one from them.
Yeah. All right. Skywrath. I mean, what do you think about Skywrath Mage? Is he good right now? He's really not in vogue. He still has a silence, you know. Amp magic damage, I guess, is pretty good. He's a hero that definitely benefits from that change to increasing your overall spell damage now.
Yeah. It's definitely buffs him up a little bit later game, but the problem with Skywrath, you have to play him support, and I know we saw a few mids like a long time ago, like 2 years, but if he dies once, he literally falls off the face of the earth.
Yeah.
And even as support, he's
paper thin.
He's super good early. Yeah, super good early game because his nuke is slowed, and his silence is super good late game, but you get super late game, and BKBs are going to come out, and Skywrath is just actually pretty useless super late game.
Yeah. I'm kind of tempted to agree. And the other problem is he doesn't really close out games. It's sort of like Lich syndrome a little bit. Like, he's really good in the lane for very different reasons, but that's where he kind of peaks. And then it's like, how do you win a game with Skywrath Mage? The mid game, he can get picked off pretty easily. There are a lot of heroes, like Nyx Assassin, for example. If they pick Nyx, I mean, what's Skywrath going to do? That is not going to be a fun game.
Yeah, exactly. And we saw Nyx yesterday. He ended up losing, but it's the first time I've seen Nyx in a while, and that was fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like watching Nyx. It's a good hero. Underrated, I think, for sure.
5 seconds remaining.
Lifestealer banned out now by Team Freedom. We saw some of those picks yesterday, not only just against the Phoenix, but just in general. A lot of Infest Bomb action.
Yeah, I'm fine with Nyx getting banned and not picked. We see a lot of him. He's just a good hero. It's kind of hard to shut down, and he's super tanky, and I mean, we see in the free farm Beeza just goes ham.
Yeah, it's true. What else does Beeza play? Like, what are his like top three heroes by choice?
I'm saying probably by choice, or just so you see him play a lot.
I mean, now I think of Beeza Void, but that's not really like a classic Beeza hero.
I mean, I think it's moving up there though. I would say it's like Slark, Naix, and then I mean, you could say like a Void. It's definitely Slark, Naix, so he
Slark,
loves both
Naix.
Those heroes. Yeah.
Okay.
And he's one of those people who doesn't mind Necrophos.
Oh yeah, the Necrophos. We saw Mojo play Necrophos.
Yeah, Mojo
yesterday.
Played. It was actually did decent against the Timbersaw. That was the game. Was that they ended up winning that? That was game two, right?
No, they lost the Necro though? Game. I think.
Didn't they?
I think
God,
so.
My mind's going to mush.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah,
all
they
the
did. Cause that,
I have
that
vivid memories.
Went ham.
Yeah, that was the Timbersaw game. I just have vivid memories of saying Mojo's Necro didn't work out in the end, even with all that farm. Because we thought it would win the late game, and then the Timbersaw was just too ridiculous. They went the double pipes.
Yep.
They just kept piping. Necro was ulting, and then they just start smoking, and it turned
start
the game
piping.
Around. I said, I think, the other day in C Kappa, Dota's like the only game where smoking saves lives.
Mm-hmm, that's true. Like, or if someone put a gun to your head and said, if you don't smoke the cigarette, you'll die.
I mean, that's one area where Valve is just way cooler than Blizzard, right? Blizzard's just like, oh, Heroes of the Storm needs to be more child-friendly. Gazlo, no more cigar for you. Oh, Tychus, you like smoking in your suit? Too bad. You're tobacco-free, buddy, now. Enjoy the nicotine patch. Valve's like, fuck that. Yeah, the Pipe of Insight in the game. We're buffing it.
Man.
You can get two of them now. Shit, get three. It's all
good.
Yeah,
and you get it on Dazzle, and you already got two pipes if you have the Dazzle pipe. That pipe's sick, too. The
yeah,
cosmetic.
Dude. That thing makes you want to try smoking. You look at it, yep. You're like, damn. I didn't know you get that artsy with it. Look at this guy. Dazzle looks healthy, right? He's doing all right.
He is. He might be... anorexic.
He's actually a little decrepit looking now. His posture leaves something.
But he's still alive, and he smokes, so that's pretty good. I feel he's alive.
That's true. Yeah, he is still alive, and that's what matters at the end of the day. Death Prophet, though, speaking of being dead, the Banshee for FDL. We saw, again, to reference Mojo, we saw him play Death Prophet yesterday. Great, great mid laner there, no doubt about it. Not too many heroes that beat her. Good team fighting. Pairs well with the Lion Doom. They've got some good lockdown to peel, counter-initiate in these team fights.
Yeah, and I mean, Freedom has that kind of burst damage setup already, and if they go for that puck, Radiant and the thing is, if FDL, depending on their carry, I mean, they're looking for that early push like we saw them do yesterday in Game 3, and yeah. they're pretty damn good at pulling that off.
Yeah. I mean, now we're definitely seeing some Veil synergy here. Veil plus, I mean, hell, they should just pick up the Ancient Apparition now, get some Ice Vortex, get yourself the Ancient Seal, and a Veil Discord, and it's just all magic all day. I don't think a pipe's saving you from that. Now the Oracle for FDL.
Yeah, they have, wow, that's gonna, I think we saw Oracle Death Prophet yesterday as well. It just, Death Prophet doesn't die, the ghosts go off longer, you Yule's above stuff, and it's really hard to kill that Death Prophet.
Yeah. Did we have it wrong? Did they win that Necro game?
Oh, we? I don't know about we, but yeah, I believe that was game two, and they won with the next Necro. Remember, they like we said they shouldn't win late game, and they did.
Oh, maybe that's right. We said they shouldn't win, and then they
if
did.
You yeah. If you ever make me doubt myself again, Zaori, I just don't know what I'll do.
All right. Well, I guess when in doubt, I'll just defer to Grant. What does my life come to?
Yeah, I don't know. Look at Puck's eyes. She has gorgeous eyes. Remaining. Like those brown hazelnut, they're
Puck's
gorgeous.
Dreamy.
Yeah,
kind of a high pitched voice though, and even more synergy. Lockdown for Team Freedom.
Ooh yeah, the problem with this is Freedom is either gonna have to run that the Faceless Void safe lane, which I mean we've seen. I'm not saying that's bad, but I feel like versus push line of Death Prophet with Oracle and Doom, I'm not sure if Faceless Void like he's gonna have to farm really well, and if he doesn't, he might just be useless.
Yeah, you're kind of right. They don't really have a late game advantage here. Even with this FDL draft, like Death Prophet has proven she can scale pretty well now with items like Octarine Core and stuff. She's much more late game oriented than she used to be, perhaps. Doom can scale quite well. Lion Oracle, probably two of the better supports in terms of, you know, 50 minutes plus, 45 minutes plus. They still have a huge impact in the game, especially the Oracle.
And, I mean, when Lion gets Blink Daggered, having someone who can blink instant disable anyone is amazing. Having an Oracle who can save anyone for a certain amount of time, I like the supports here. And Lion, I mean, we saw yesterday, he can get solo kills on even carry heroes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Where he survived with, like, 10 HP and just did the Hex finger. Oh, wait a second. Yeah, I just destroyed you. Enchantress now. All right, the off lane for IX Mike banned out. I was thinking this would likely be Mike on either Void or Beastmaster.
Yeah,
Yeah,
I was thinking maybe Beastmaster, but judging how they're picking and banning it, it could be a jungle Beastmaster again after they saw FDL pull it off reasonably successfully, even though he got harassed by the Phoenix.
Yeah, so maybe Freedom thinking if we can pull it off without somebody intercepting us, they banned out the Bounty Hunter Phoenix right away. Those are the two heroes that we've seen do it now. Okay. Maybe some indication there, and wow, Freedom goes with the Kunkka.
Radiant team pick. I don't even know anymore. Juby is just, he's one of those guys, yo, come on, man. Last game, that wasn't indicative of my skill, you know. You got to give me that. You got to give me it again. I've seen Juby talking in real life.
Was that an accurate Juve impersonation?
Yeah, that was. He is, okay. Yeah, he went to a lot of lands in Dota 1 in Canada. And I believe he was, I mean, he went to KDL lands, too. Yeah, Blitz. I'm sure he's heard him talk.
Wait, where does Juve live?
He lives in Canada now, but he was in he was on MVP Hot. I think he had the longest run on a Korean team of anyone. He was on MVP Hot 6 for 2 years.
Was he,
which is insane.
Was he at MLG Columbus 2013 on
Swag? Yes. Yeah, that was him. He was probably the guy with the afro, yeah.
I did meet him once then, actually. Yeah. It was like, who else was on that team? Pandago?
Pandago, Ryuborus? Was Ryuborus. He on that team, or was he off? I'm a Sheep Sucks, Liesel?
Yeah.
Those were all the members, like, they
I
rotated
met them all
through, like,
in passing. And I didn't know any of them. So it was one of those just like, oh, hello, yeah, new people. So I now know Pandago better. But that's it. One and only time I saw Juve.
Did he have the fro, or was he short-haired? It's either short hair or fro at the time.
God, I can't remember, dude. I want to say fro, but part of me remembers. I saw them in the food court, and part of me wants to say, a little bit of my brain said, who's the dude with the afro?
Yeah, it probably was. That's still my favorite picture in all of Dota 2. It's his MVP Hot 6, his four Koreans, and then just the black dude with the afro. I was like, this is literally, it's like the best picture in esports at the time. It was just funny.
I actually remember
really
that.
Good.
And I thought it was just a troll. That's so funny. Amazing. That's brilliant, yeah. Actually. That is good shit. All right, yeah. Speaking of scary, Spectre, the final pick for Bisa.
And I like this because we've seen with the new, I wouldn't even say new Spectre, the 6 months ago Spectre that's in with the phase boots, urn, drum. Mm-hmm. I mean, it can fight early. I mean, it still scales super good late. So you get a Death Prophet push while your Spectre's farming. You just TP in with that Spectre, and oh, man. It's always nice having that global presence we always talk about.
Yeah, you're right. It is a really good pick here, actually. They already had pretty good late game. Now the late game is secured, and I completely agree with you. Spectre has become, I mean, honestly, I think Spectre and Medusa, to bring her back up again, they have that similar vein where they're notorious for being that, oh, they're only good in the late game. But if you itemize right and get active, you know, Stonegaze is really good in those early mid-game fights. You know, you can use Haunt and fight at level 6 if you have phase boots and the beginnings of an Aquila or something, even just a basic kit. I think Vanguard Spectre can be good. You see it a lot less in pro games because once the other team sees it, they'll just go defensive and, you know, not really let you take fights, and then it can become kind of a sunk cost. But if you're fighting a lot, going for an early Vanguard can definitely be a value pickup on the Spectre in certain games.
Yeah, it's kind of, I hate to say it, but it's kind of fun seeing Vanguard again. That hero used to be so big in early Dota 1, or early Dota 2, late Dota 1, and it fell off for so long, and now it's like, yep, everyone's getting it again.
Well, Vanguard's also one of those funky items that has, like, stealthy nerfs and buffs to it with, you know, does it block damage pre or post mitigation? You know, how much damage does it block? What's the percentage that it blocks? I feel like it's been tweaked a lot over the ages. I remember when Han turned their shitty Vanguard version into having, like, charges that regenerate over time. That was weird.
Yeah, the Helm of the Black Legion. I still remember that name.
God damn it, dude. I tried. What an off. Vanguard is a great name. That's just that it rolls off the tongue. Helm of the Black Legion. It's like, who the fuck is the Black Legion? Would you just throw that in there?
Yeah, it sounds like a cosmetic more than an actual item.
Yeah.
So we're going to see the Death Prophet Puck matchup again. We saw this yesterday, and didn't the Puck destroy the Death Prophet yesterday? Like, really bad, if
I
recall? I
think so, but if I also recall, that was a CC&C Puck game, right? I think he played Puck yesterday. So I'll actually be curious to see if that was more of a player thing or if that was just a straight matchup thing. Down bottom, though, Franz could be the first blood victim. Eagle doing big damage. One more auto attack. Not quite going to have it. Now Bisa looking to set it up. Fortune's End comes flying in. It's going to be a first blood the other way. Spectre picks it up, and now Mike is on the run. I think he's going to survive here. Franz actually needs to be really careful. Can't tank this creep wave. It's still a 3-on-1. They've got a lot of low-health heroes here, but Franz's positioning, like, he wants to go in for more. He'll just deny to the neutrals after picking up a couple of TV scrolls. Now Bisa needs to be careful, though. This is the power of the Skywrath. He's squishy early on, but he is a glass cannon. He turns it back around, and just like that, 1-to-1, Spectre falls.
That's what he said. The Skywrath is so strong, like, in the super early game. That's why he does so good. You have to win your lanes, and... I mean, they gave up the first blood, but that's a huge kill. Killing Bisa, I think, is almost worth it there. Giving him first blood.
Yeah, definitely. Help the TP back in. Mid lane, it's an even spread this time, at least so far. CCNC staying aggressive on the Sunbee, but they are in a dead heat. 8 last hits apiece. Let's check in on the top lane. MJW, pretty aggressive here. 5 last hits.
All Mike might be trapped.
Good time. Uh-oh, down back bottom, Mike. He's going to make it out. They're going to do heavy damage onto Stan King. They'll actually get the kill. Eagle finds the last auto attack to secure it. Franz trying to lay in the right clicks. But now they're on the defensive. Bisa getting low. And it looks like everyone else is going to live. But now the TP back in from Oracle. Can they turn this back around onto Mike? Fortune's End gets channeled up. The dagger across the trees. And they'll get another one. 2-2. They trade even once more.
Yeah, it feels like these are perfect trades for Freedom. And then they just overextend a little bit. And it goes back in favor of FDL.
Yeah, I mean, these are also weird because both of these last few skirmishes have revolved around whoever died first respawning quickly and then TPing back in, and then that being the overwhelming force that turns the fight back towards mid lane. Middle. Sunbee getting low. I thought a Crypt Swarm might actually put him in kill range there, but he did have a phase shift, so I guess not.
Yeah, phase shift, very far. Ooh, he's going to get an invisibility rune. Not much a Puck can do at level 4 with that, but
yeah,
better than nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. Still fills up the bottle. But this is going the way of the DP. So, you know, maybe this is what we can gather from this is CCNC is just a damn good mid laner. Uh-oh. Hold that thought, though. MJW up top. X, Torrent. This could be another kill for Freedom. It sure is. Kunkka getting credit for this one.
Yeah, we've seen Juby did good last game as well, early with those X Torrents, like getting him a bunch of kills. The problem is he had quite a few fail boats as well once he was needed for those.
We'll I think Spectre would be going. Well advised to pick up a wand in this lane. I think against Skywrath, that is what it's like. There's a few like Batrider, Bristleback. I think Skywrath is pretty high on that list of just instant wand pickup when you have to lane against him.
Yep. Oh, and he could be in trouble, Eagle. Oh no, line's a little farther back.
Almost though. Skywrath is such a wild hero in this scenario. He puts on so much pressure but dies so quickly. Bisa manning up way too aggressive here. It's like his supports weren't ready for it. Skywrath eats a fairy fire, actually turns onto Franz. It's a 2-for-1. Stan King, the lone survivor here for FDL. He's on the run. Mike trying to chase him down. He does have an orb of venom, so it's going to be a pretty easy commitment. Double kill now for the Beastmaster. That was incredible for Freedom. They'll be happy to throw away the life of that Skywrath mage if they can get trades like that. Mike now almost level 5.
Yeah, look at Skywrath's items, too. I have not seen this build in a while.
What? He hits for 80 in auto attack, though. It's actually kind of incredible.
Yeah, and he has plenty more like 900 HP for a Skywrath this early against a tri-lane, and he has plenty of mana. Like, the only reason they didn't get more kills is he didn't have mana, and now he does. They're both pretty high level. This whole bottom lane's reasonably high level. The Spectre and the Tri-Lane's 4. Mike's 5. Skywrath, man, that Skywrath is really scary, though, since he's, look at this, boom. Had like a fourth of his HP in one blast.
Yeah, Franz is the only one that's really struggling here. He's the one that's been getting the short end of the stick. He went Windlace, Brown Boot, so he's pretty speedy. He can make these rotations happen, but only level 2. So there's the Hex to initiate. He's got the follow-up stun, CCNC. Drops the Soul Siphon, and there's the phase shift into Illusory Orb out. Puck lives, no problemo.
Yep, own. God, they're just so aggressive on bottom. They can be now. And this, like I said, this is how Ix Mike likes to play. Like, we saw him suicide a kill earlier for a kill, and that's why he loves Abaddon so much. It's a super good hero for that. And I guess Skywrath is looking the same here.
Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at the overall graphs. Wow, Freedom with about a 1,500 net worth lead. Up by 3 kills. This has been a really good laning stage for them. Mike is number 1 on net worth right now. Last game we were talking about the power of the jungling Beastmaster, what happens when he gets intercepted, kind of theory crafting into this one, but the 2-1-2 from Freedom has really worked out, and it has secured Mike way more farm than this safe lane Spectre. Beast's actually been shut down pretty hard. Only 17 last hits. That's fairly lackluster overall compared to like the 34 of the Death Prophet, for example. This is a pretty struggling Spectre.
It isn't. I agree with you. I think a stick would have been huge in this lane. It would have given him a lot more survivability as well as sustain.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Worth updating here. Our admin didn't get... we had a remake and missed the ticker for game number two. But FDL is up 1-0 in this series, folks. So if they win this one, Team Freedom's out of the tournament. Say goodbye to your run in Canada Cup Season 7.
Yeah, and that's FDL would be... That puts them top four, right, I believe?
Mm-hmm. I think so.
Yeah, that's really good. This is... Canada Cup's had some good teams. I think Narvi 2 won the last series. Complexity won before that.
Mm-hmm.
There's been some prestigious winners, and now it's looking like DC or Complexity are poised to possibly add their name on the Trophy of Champions, the Canadian Maple Leaf Trophy.
The Stanley Cup of Dota.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, the Stan King. Okay, that was...
Almost, yeah.
But if he wins, I feel maybe we name the trophy after him.
That's true, actually. Stan King is a pretty badass name. You know, you want to say Sand King. It kind of plays, it's like Irish wristwatch. Hard, easy to read, hard to say.
Yep. All right. Stanley King.
Stanley.
Ooh, and Biza.
Oh, he's going to find him. X, Torrent. Nope. A little bit scared of the possible rotations. There was an Oracle nearby. Yeah. Only level 4, but...
I don't think he would have gotten that kill. He could have tried for it, but I think it was smart. He just baited out. Now he sentries the camp, so Biza can't even farm that or stack it.
Kunkka, the Smoke of Deceit master here. He's got the sticky icky. He actually picks up another one back home. I'm curious if Jubei can keep up this momentum. You mentioned it like in the last game where he starts off strong. But it's the mid game where Kunkka is pretty hard. You miss just a couple of boats, and all of a sudden they're knocking on your high ground.
Oops, yep, and we see bottom. They should be able to find Mike here pretty easily. We'll see, though.
Yeah, they have a Doom. It could be the easy way
to
roar
him. They're all three just so slow. Oh, there we go.
All right, so no one's going to use any ults, and a Fortune's End will be the deal sealer. All right.
That's nice. Spectre just got a 350 kill, and he's going to be able to free farm bottom for a bit. That's actually a really big kill there.
Yeah, definitely. Mid lane now actually moving in favor of the puck. Is that just a difference in CS or what's... No, their CS is still dead even, but I guess is that just tower gold there? Yeah, 400 gold or so. All right.
And we see the we were talking about the Death Prophet going this... he actually getting level... He got ult at level 6 both games yesterday we saw played in this game. Finally gets it at level 8.
Okay, so yeah, there is a difference
a little
here.
Later, yeah.
This game has definitely been pretty slow tempo. Like, we saw a lot of kills just in this bottom lane because it was where five heroes were, but overall, this has been pretty quiet, and I think it's a good read from CCNC realizing he's not going to need the ult that early on. But now Freedom smoking up towards the top lane. Franz, I think, destined to get killed here. It's a 4-on-1. They easily dive the tower. Necro Book, level 1, already out, and they're just going to drop the Lion. Poor guy, he was just trying to leech to get to level 6. It's all he wanted. It's all he wants in the world is a finger of death.
And, well, his world has collapsed upon him, and looks like it's just a free tower for Freedom now. All 5 rotate here.
Yep. Easy peasy.
We'll play the numbers game for some gold.
Mid lane, though, CCNC uses his first Exorcism, so they'll do some decent damage to this tier 1.
And he used it while he had the Arcane rune up, so smart.
Oh, that's huge. Yeah. Honestly, I mean, it becomes less of a factor later on, but those first couple ults for DP are pretty telling. And being able to get her on that low cooldown is huge. Yeah, look at this. Freedom, no holds barred. They're just going to keep on going. Back-to-back towers and FDL. Seems like they're not quite sure how to react here. They'll just commit to the tier 1 mid instead and trade 2-for-1. It's pretty early to be losing a tier 2 tower.
Yeah, it's so scary to TP into that, because if you TP in, the Skywrath will just instant silence you, and you know the Void still has ult. Because you haven't seen it once yet, so they're just going to lose a tier 2 tower by not setting up. Maybe they're fine with that, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, Beastmaster's ult's like right around the corner. Kunkka has an X and a Torrent that he can set up. That you're right, that is a scary TP back to try and defend. Death Prophet with an invisibility rune. No ultimate, not sure what CCNC is going to be able to do here. Maybe get a free kill on Mike, but it's going to cost him life possibly. No, Beastmaster comes right in.
It cost Jubia's life.
Haunts in. Oh my god, what a great setup here. The invisibility rune from CCNC makes it all possible. They find Boris. Connect with a Chronosphere. Decent ult from the Skywrath. Brings Biza low, but it might not even be enough. The Doom ult comes out. Finger of Death returns enough damage for Spectre to secure the kill. Or, pardon me, no. Wait, how did the Spectre die there? I guess Skyrath got one last auto attack.
He got cued at the last second.
Oh, okay. There was one last cue that came out. I twisted my brain into a pretzel, and I was about to say that Spectre died to Desolate from the finger, but that's not quite how that works.
Wait a minute. Yeah, that's... Wow. And look at that. Just like that, a 4-for-1 trade this early. That was a weird 4 deaths for Team Freedom.
Yeah, it really was. I mean, Freedom were getting a lot of momentum, but that fight now actually... It kind of gets FDL right back into this. Spectre, who is really struggling to farm, is now kind of par for the course. MJW getting chased down. Sunbee doing some good damage here. Drops the Dream Coil. He's going to try to wait it out. Not going to snap the tether, but there's a Primal Roar waiting. And there was a Torrent on the way. That'll be the end of the Doom as he lingers around a bit too long. So they get a recovery kill. That's nice.
They do, and I think Freedom really wants to push here before Death probably gets level 11 and a Yules. Pair that with the Oracle, and I just don't see how you stand a fight against that Death Prophet.
Yeah. All right, let's take a look here. I'm going to relive that team fight. As like you mentioned, it was sort of an awkward 4 deaths for the Dire side. So with that, we're going to move into our Soylent Instant Replay. And here we go. CCNC starts it off. Invisibility Rune destroys Mike straight away as he gets greedy on the creeps. The Spectre reality's in. They'll get another easy kill onto the Kunkka. And then Boris decides, hey, I think we can fight this. Eagle has an ult. He drops it. It does a little bit of split damage, brings the Spectre low, but now they kill the Void. And Eagle's only hope is to try to get that one last final kill before he falls. And of course he does. But just like that, FDL take a successful fight. And now this game is their oyster, Grant.
Yep, and the clam inside of the oyster can once again become a pearl.
Oh, so that's how that works. I always wondered how they made pearls. Tier 1 tower mid falls. Dire will finish that one off. So 2 outer towers remaining for FDL. They are still losing a lot of map control. That is one thing that is cause for concern.
Especially against the Beastmaster Hawk. And I don't know if you noticed Skyrath's build. He went into a Veil of Discord no boots build.
Wow. That's bold.
Bold, Cotton.
Yeah. Ooh, double vanguards now.
Uh-oh, this could be... I don't know if Franz wants to run into just... Line and oh, nice scan.
Yeah, it's a 6 scan right here. I mean, FDL are definitely itching to fight. Spectre did go for that Vanguard build we were talking about. So now it's not just an option to fight if the other team puts pressure on, but they kind of have to. And oh, what a perfect time to ult. They're about to gank him. He realities up. They set up the kill on the Void instead. And the two heroes rotating in the Radiant Jungle walk away empty-handed. Sunbee going to jaunt into the tree line here. And looks like he'll just TP home. They're not going to have any way to interrupt it. That was a clutch play from Bisa. I'm not sure if that was... There might have been a small stroke of luck there. Like, he ulted in reality kind of right away. But as soon as he saw the enemies, he was like, yeah, I'm out of here.
Yeah, and then he gets a kill up top, too, and they get a tower. He's like, man, that was a double... What's a... what's a double-edged sword, but if it's good?
Well, a double-edged sword pastry? Means there's one...
It's bad, yeah.
No, it's good and bad. Like, Centaur's thing is a double-edged sword because he does big damage
bad.
And he takes big damage. Well, it's double-edged because
how does that
a good
saying work?
What, double-edge?
Yeah, because, I mean, a sword's always bad. Violence is never the answer, especially in Dota. What if the teams just talked it out? Like, what? If Puck... I feel Puck is kind of a demigod. He just talks out with Spectre, who's, I mean, pretty godly.
Yeah.
Really could work something out.
And then they bring in Silencer, and he's just the Stonewall, the guy you can't initiate with. He's just like, no, shut the fuck up.
And then he just fights and kills somebody. Like, come on, Nortrum. Of course, the guy named Nortrum would be the one killing people.
Yeah,
stupid
the founder
Nortrum.
Of Nordstrom's. He is pretty classy, honestly. He's pretty hot. Well, this game is really slowed down. These teams playing as if their tournament life is on the line here. CCNC moves into the Yule Scepter, first core item that he's picked up since the power treads. And
bottom.
Yeah, Bisa gets set up on here. Doom from MJW, maybe pulling the trigger on that just a little soon. Now set up from Kunkka. X Torrent connects on 2. In comes the Chrono right into Ghost Ship. It's a good setup. Bisa and MJW in trouble. There is the False Promise. CCNC joins the party with an Exorcism. Boris trying to make it out. He's already used one time walk. Bisa gets a big heal from the Oracle. Dream Coil on 2, Sunbee comes in, does a big rotation. CCNC now dies to the Primal Roar and all the follow-up damage. MJW can't take this heat, and he will fall. It's an awkward fight for FDL. They lose 2, and maybe even 3 here as Bisa's on the run. It looks like he'll live. Lion wasn't even a part of that fight. Franz was just up top farming. He's really close to his blink dagger, so it might have been worth it for him to stay split push and farm, but I don't think FDL can afford to take these fights 4v5.
Yeah, I think that was the biggest thing. That Doom just wore off. Ike's might position himself perfectly, and he got the roar off on the, was it Death Prophet before he could Yules, and Death Prophet just died even with his ult up and Yules off cooldown.
Alright, tier 2 tower down. Only one outer tower remains for FDL. Let's take a look at dire coverage, ward coverage here. Pretty interesting ward spot right here. Not the typical spot you'd normally think about the plateau, but I guess a lot less likely this will get counter warded. And we've also got another one up here near the Radiant Ancients giving some intel into that entryway. So Dire Vision sees this rotation. They know exactly what's going on. Oh no, they're smoked up. Okay, they don't see shit. And because of that, Mike's going to get ganked. Yep. All right, there you go. Pretty good smoke rotation. Bit off
more than I could. And I mean, this is still Spectre, still getting probably get about a 22-minute Radiance. And that's not terrible. We saw him get dumpstered in the lane pretty hard.
Yeah.
This would be a nice comeback.
Oh, this is the great part about the Vanguard. He's 3-3-6 now in KDA, so he actually has been able to participate in these fights pretty effectively. And I mean, there is some good natural synergy with a tanky item like that on Spectre. Just lets you spit out more damage with Dispersion. And he's gone for the Desolate build here.
And I think that Doom wasn't too bad by MJW. I think you're right. He used a little early. He just didn't want him to get Roar off at all.
Yeah.
But the problem is they tried to chase after that, and the puck came into the fight late, and it was actually, well, it's not late if it was perfect timing, I guess, for him, and he just saved that ult for CC&C, who accidentally broke the coil, got silenced, and right into a roar.
Down bottom, boat. It's a fail boat. Now X onto Bisa. Uh-oh, this Spectre's in some trouble. Coil, primal roar, and level 3 Necro Book. My god, that's a lot of damage.
Yup.
All right.
This is not. Yeah, this is nice for the puck. He didn't have to go Veil because, I mean, the Skyrath already has it.
Yeah, that's true. He gets to invest in early power treads.
Yeah. So Boris, I mean, Boris is still Boris's farm is a little lackluster for where they're at, but an aid. Ooh, I wonder if do they give the Void the Aegis? I think you almost give it to the puck here.
Yeah,
because I mean,
Sunday really is their frontliner. Yeah. Boris has only been going in when he has Chrono for the most part.
Oh, MGW,
he walks right in. He gets Dagon to the face. Ult from Skyrath does a lot of damage, but he just mechs through it. And MJW actually lives with a fair bit of HP to spare. He does have a cloak, so a little more tanky than usual. Attack. Are they actually going to commit to this Roche? Looks like Darl's going to move out of the pit. He's still very healthy at 50% HP. Okay.
No, Boris. Oh, got him. Huh, yeah, both teams, they're just going to be completely fine with decommitting. This, I mean, fights like these help FDL, obviously, because their Spectre can just be free farming. Freedom has to commit all five heroes no matter what, while Spectre, I mean, Spectre can just come to a fight whenever he wants.
Yeah, and at this point, I mean, Bisa is really close to this Relic. He's got 3k gold, so the Radiance is imminent. And it's going to be a lot harder for Team Freedom once that comes out. I mean, the blind actually does start to make a difference in terms of just general survivability, and the damage output is going to go up a lot.
Yeah,
still
that's
itching to fight,
always
though.
Scary.
Oh, here we go. Actually going to haunt this. Who do we go on? Reality in onto Jubei. And Spectral Dagger towards IX Mike. Primal Roar and the Necro Book. Bisa loses all of his mana. But Mike taking big damage here. I think definitely going down. Oh no, not quite. Almost gets healed up, but will fall. Boris gets off his ult, but also gets doomed and fingered. It just kind of tickles. CC&C gets off a late ult. He's stuck inside of the Dream Coil. Boris, meanwhile, in the back line near Sunbee. Bisa kind of low on HP. This is such an awkward fight. CC&C takes a huge burst of damage. I think he actually just killed the Necro Book with his spirits. Oh my god, dude, that is so unfortunate. FTL's gonna get wiped up here. Bisa might be able to live, but it's a 2-for-4 at the very least. Disastrous fight for FDL.
That's what it was, right?
The ghost killed the Necro unit?
Yeah, and he went down from like 900 to like 200 HP, and then the Void just changed. He somehow got the kill on the Void. The ghost did work, and then, yeah, he just died. That was rather unfortunate. Oh, the torrent just barely missed Bisa because he was actually standing on the hill.
Yeah, that's kind of cheeky.
They know he didn't have a teleport, though. I mean, the pro players click on your items, and they'll know.
Well, now he picks one up. Just barely gets enough mana for it, and he TPs out. God, that's so unfortunate for the Death Prophet. That is one counter to that hero that I never really thought of. Just buy Necro units, and you can only kind of control what sort of damage the ghosts do. I mean, I don't think that's very repeatable, I guess you could say. It's sort of just lucky RNG that it was low on HP and the ghost happened to hit it. But, I mean, that's like game-breaking for FDL there. He had so much HP with a pretty decent duration ult. Yeah, they're going to go right in onto Sunbee. MJW doesn't have the Doom, though. Can they actually get this kill? I don't think so.
It's good old fun. You can blink out of Scorched Earth, even though the ground's literally on fire. I don't know how you're not taking damage canceling that blink. It's on fire.
I guess technically it's like you blink out of the Roshna. Phase shift realm, you know?
So yeah, I guess.
You just go straight from phase to blink. Really unfortunate timing for FDL on that. Spectre's ult was just coming up. Literally came off cooldown in the same second that Roche died. So no chance to even get him to scatter around the pit. But Team Freedom know that. You know, that is one of the weaknesses of this FDL draft. If Exorcism, Haunt, Finger, and Doom are all on cooldown, you know they're not really looking to take a fight. Even if you don't have Chrono, they still, you know, they need the Exorcism for the damage.
Yep. And this Void finally still, I mean, the Void, that's the problem. The Void is actually not finding any farm anywhere. I think this game would be a lot, I mean, super in favor of Freedom if he even had his Radiance right now. But it looks like Visa's still going to beat him to it.
Yeah. Boris is actually pretty far away, you're right. 2,200. It felt like that's he was farming a lot better, but the Puck is the one, I mean, like the vacuum that's just sucking up all this farm. He's got a level 4 Dagon already.
He can burst someone down as long as he doesn't get doomed. Luckily, he's been coming into the fights a little bit in the later phase, and I think that's smart, making sure the doom's not on him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree. And I, you know, it is nice that you've got the Skywrath to go for Veil, but it does limit a little bit of the Puck's like solo pickoff potential. You know, Eagles had pretty good positioning, but there will still be some circumstances where the Skywrath isn't going to be right there next to the Puck. So I don't know. It's interesting.
MJW might be in trouble.
Yeah, they're looking for it. FDL do not want to fight right now. Spectre is 1,000 gold away from Radiance. It's going to be hanging on to all this unreliable gold. MJW does get caught, though. Dream Coil Dagon will try to TP out. Yeah, that's not happening.
It's not happening versus the Veil Dagon Mystic Flare.
Yeah. Even with a Hood of Defiance. I don't think he activated it, but still. They just cut right through it. He is going to go for a pipe. Definitely a smart call this game. Plenty of magic damage to warrant that.
Yeah, but if you notice, Skywrath, only one point in his ult. The mana cost increase of that hero's ultimate is actually, it holds that hero back a lot.
800 at level 3?
Yeah, 225 mana increase for, what, 400 damage? That is just, it's not worth it at all. Yeah, and, I mean, look at his mana pool.
No mana, nowhere to go. Spectre will actually haunt for this, though. That's kind of unfortunate.
Yeah, they were hoping maybe they could do some, but yeah, that was just a good Hawk. Hawk scouts out CC&C after he farms a wave and tries to hide in the forest.
Yeah.
And they find him.
Yep. All right, FDL, how big is the deficit here? Actually, not that big. Only like 6, 7K, 5K experience. It's a decent lead for Team Freedom, but they're still a ways from closing this game out. They have a great team fighting team, but their ability to break high ground is a little bit tough. Like, they need to wipe FDL and then do high ground that way. They can't really take a conventional fight. FDL, though, I mean, they're like one good team fight away from being right back in this game and then another team fight after that from just running down all of these outer structures and picking up all of all that yummy gold.
Yeah, and we saw this with when we remembered that sorry, I'm just spacing words right now. The Death Prophet from Shazam, they just won one team fight and won like an 80-minute game somehow, and we didn't think they had a shot.
Yeah,
it just takes one fight with the Death Prophet and a Spectre too.
But look at this, Void actually opting to skip the Radiance. He goes Vanguard Diffusal.
Okay.
So
I like it.
Be that Manta build, as we've seen, you know, get those illusions through the big mana burn, but big difference here in terms, like, the thing with the Radiance is it allows the Void to farm super fast. We've talked about this. I mean, safe lane Void has the drawback of not farming particularly well if he falls behind. He doesn't really have flash farming, and You know, Radiance makes anybody a good farmer.
Yeah.
So now he's a little more pickoff oriented. Sunbee jumping in, almost destroys the Oracle with the axe. That's cheeky.
And that's well, you pretty much just saw the Kunkka Tinker strategy employed.
Yep.
Except they just do that for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is really annoying for Sieging High Ground, though.
Yeah, it is.
They've used and False Promise and Pipe now. Or, oh, yeah, that's just a hood. Okay.
Yeah, sorry. Big thing, the Skywrath actually picked up an Atos, and that the true strike it provides actually kind of nullifies the miss chance on Radiance now.
Wait, it's does it still smart. Have true strike? Didn't they remove
it? I thought
that?
It did. Did they remove it?
It's not on the tooltip. I'm pretty sure they removed that. They changed it with what's the Orchid upgrade called? The Bloodthorn?
Oh, Bloodthorn,
I think
yeah.
When that came out, they took it off of Atos.
Oh, okay. So they buffed the item to make it actually kind of useful, and now they... Okay, whatever.
I think the idea was that it was such an odd, like...
Weird thing to put on
yeah,
it.
Yeah, like, the few heroes that would buy Atos, it's like, are you ever really going to buy an Atos so that you can counteract, like, a small miss chance? Like, it was just too weird and niche-specific.
Yeah.
And it's... I mean, it's not a cheap item. You know, it's not expensive,
oh,
but...
Smoke gank.
MJW, here we go. It's FDL that gets the catch. Doom and a stun onto IX Mike. He's definitely going down. Instead, they focus onto Eagle. No deny comes out, and the Skywrath definitely falls too. It's going to be Oracle that gets credit for that kill. Void, he'll just time walk out. FDL have to be happy with that. That's a great catch right there.
Yeah, it is. That was such a good stun by Franz. The double stun onto both of them into that ult, and that's a lot of gold.
Yep. It
okay,
sure
55%,
is.
55%, not bad, hey? That's better than 50%. Being better than average is always good.
2,500 net worth swing. I'll take that.
Yeah, and they're going to get a tier 1 tower, probably.
Yeah, going on to Sunbee, the X back. All right. I actually almost could have grabbed him there because of the duration of the Hex. But here we go again. X. He almost dies this time. He does.
What happened? How did he get brought back?
What broke the X?
No, he went back, I'm pretty sure, but... Did he orb forward and accidentally click to his orb? Because he got X back and his orb was going forward.
All right,
he might have jimmied himself. You've got the replay, my friend.
I saved the instant replay. We're going to wait until after this fight. Remind me after this, though.
That's huge. They're going to get a tier 2 and a 600 gold puck kill because I believe it was a Sunbee himself mistake.
Looks like just a misclick. Here we go. Boat comes in. It's going to be off the mark. Does clear out the creep wave, which is pretty helpful.
That's a fail, Boat.
Still, Cardi's alive. And yeah, they're just going to finish off this tower. CCNC pressing forward. Has about a quarter duration left on the Ghost, but this is where you want to try to get the hell out of here. Uh-oh, Chronosphere going to catch the stragglers. Spectre left behind and just obliterated by the magic damage. MJW probably going to get left behind as well. Necronomicon taking away all of his mana. Oracle gives him the False Promise. And I don't know if it's going to be enough. Close call. He TP's out. Oh, God,
wow.
He actually makes it. Clutch stuff from the Oracle.
Yep. And that was just a misplay again from the Spectre, though. He TP'd. I mean, you know they have a Hawk. They have a ward right where the tower is, and the ward
both.
Just spots him out. Yeah, you can't TP out like that versus a Void.
Yeah. Well, if you do, you know, you're basically just closing your eyes and hoping for the best. All right, let's see here. Let's run back the videotape.
Get the VHS running. Make sure to rewind it before it goes to Blockbuster.
Yep. All right. Here we go. The Soylent instant replay. How did the puck die? Sunbee's unfortunate demise. So here we are zoomed out. He's already done this little cheeky play once. He hops in. He orbs forward. Yeah, it looks like he does jaunt, and it just cancels the X. So let's see here. Let's watch it one more time.
I mean, because he got X back and instantly jaunts forward again, I think, on accident.
It's hard to see. It happens really fast. So he blinks in. There's the X. Yeah, they just mistime it. He literally jaunts like half a second after he gets X'd. That's really unfortunate.
Yeah, I've seen that. Oh, Beez is somewhere. Illusion. I hear him cast ult.
Where are they going?
Or is he just escaping?
Oh, it's up top.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they go. They get the puck again. Sorry, I was a little slow on that one. Getting back out of the instant replay.
This is insane. The Spectre like wasn't farming super quick, and now he's got his Radiance. He has a Yasha as well as 1.5k. That fight bottom was...
Yeah,
pretty game-changing. Look at the gold grip.
Puck's number one on net worth, so like these pickoffs.
Two kills.
Yeah, that was like a 1,500 net worth swing just with that pickoff right there. This game is pretty close to even, and Puck, who was dominating the net worth charts, not only ahead by like 1,500, Spectre's closing this gap, and fast.
And I love CC and C's build. He's like, well, this Puck is pretty much the only problem right now. BKB Hood.
Bisa just got obliterated. That was even with a pipe from the Doom, and he just got destroyed. This magic damage is too much. Honestly, he might just want to go for a Hood of Defiance of his own. I know Spectre needs to go damage, but like just having that extra pipe buff for himself plus that magic resistance, it could at least counteract the Veil. Did you see how fast he died in that chrono? Like, that was like two seconds.
He got evaporated quicker than your milk after it sits out on the counter.
That's true, yeah. I mean, honestly, a casual Hood on Spectre is definitely not the worst thing in the world.
It used to be pretty... I think, like, the Vanguard to Hood build used to be quite a thing in, I think, early Dota 2. Yeah, it was just... I mean, you might as well, because Desolate does so much damage early game, you didn't really need damage. But even now, yeah, I mean, you see DP's build. I think he has the right idea.
All right, let's see. What's DP working on?
Oh, he's got the Black King Bar Hood. Yeah, he's just got HP and the BKB, so he's fine getting... he's not going to take much from that Dagon, yeah.
So he's pretty speedy, has the reset tool. Yeah, they're definitely prioritizing the magic resistance. They're going to have two pipes at some point once DP upgrades hers, and Stan King has already picked up the Glimmer Cape. So, yeah, they're definitely prioritizing it. Lion's picked up his second mobility tool in the Force Staff. Dire's side, what are we looking at here? Void's now picked up his Yasha, no big surprise. Manta coming out next. Now that Puck's at level 5 Dagon, looks like, well, could be an Ags, could be an Octarine. But I think Ags, actually, the Ags upgrade on Puck is often forgotten about. 4.5 second stun that goes through BKB.
That's huge, and it's like, what, 5 seconds long?
Yeah.
When you break it, yeah, and it lasts longer too, so it's pretty rough. The only problem is, I guess, if you're on a Puck, the Puck can just Yule himself and it takes a little bit of it away, but on everyone else, that's really good.
Yep.
DP, yeah.
Yeah, on the DP, yeah. And Kunkka's actually gone for the Aether Lens. Now he can X from super far away.
Yeah, and they scout out the Roshan already. Jubu is just sitting in the pit for bottom.
Yeah, Blink Hex right in onto Mike. They're going to use the Haunt to get vision of the Dire team. They almost bring down Mike, but he does actually survive. He Glimmer... Oh no, he Shadow Blades back. CCNC uses the BKB, pops the Exorcism. Sunbee's been the one that's taken the Doom. Boris drops a Chronosphere, goes in onto Bisa, realizes that's not happening. Boat does come in, actually does a little bit of damage to the Lion. Team Freedom taking a lot of damage, but they disengage damn well. And this is all of the ults of FDL. They don't get a single kill out of it. Exorcism, almost done. Sunbee jumps out of the base, takes some damage, but this time he gets the combo off proper. They're gonna X Oracle. This is really awkward for FDL. Everyone's still alive, but
both teams.
Pretty much all of the
roar.
Ults have been used, except, oh, the roar.
Nice.
What a
silence.
What a silence. CCNC.
Someone's dying, I have a feeling. There has to be someone dying. Yeah, there we go.
MJW, X back, Puck, BOTN, FDL acting like they want to fight this. Mike taking big damage here. He's actually going to be the first to fall. Mystic Flare comes out, but minimal damage. Dream Coil as well kind of holds him in place, but now they scout out Jubi in the tree line. Not enough mana for the TP, nowhere to go. Purifying Flames bring him low. It's a twofer. And even after that long drawn-out initiation where FDL don't find any kills with their ultimates, they clean it up and they get a 2-0.
Yeah, that was crazy. I thought that was going to be a good initiation. I think Mike, that was a perfect silence. I think that saved him by CCNC on the Invisible Beastmaster, and I think that won him that fight. If you want to call it a fight.
Yeah, Invisible Puck now lingering nearby, slowly ticking down to the Radiance Burn. Boris on his way in. Chrono down for 15.
Indeed. Right. I feel Freedom wants to find these fights, and FDL's fine just farming and taking fights. Like, if they can counter-initiate with the Spectre, then they're fine with that, and I think that's what kind of... I'm not sure if FDL, they're technically not ahead yet, but Spectre going into the late game and being able to just always split push with him is so nice.
They've been playing around the Spectre Radiance really effectively too. Basically, since Bisa's picked it up, he's been doing nothing but split farming and picking fights, like you said, and they found so many pickoffs with it. It feels like every haunt they're finding at least one kill, even if it's just like on that puck who's split pushing. Finding these constant pickoffs has allowed them to claw their way back into this game and keep Team Freedom from just taking over. I mean, we saw them confidently walk into Roche. They got him down to half health, and they still haven't been able to kill him since then.
Yeah, I think the builds from FDL are perfect. We see a heart going to be picked up on Spectre as well as DP. Ooh, wow. Sunbeel barely get out. But yeah, CC&C has a heart and about 1,000 gold. Spectre still needs more, but I think this is a smart thing. Just tank up, and this Skywrath is pretty much useless at this point. I mean, his damage is pretty low. That's the problem with this hero.
Freedom moving to the Roche pit now. They know the Haunts is down, so FDL don't have that easy scouting tool to just jump in the pit, and it seems like this one will just go uncontested. Freedom will get themselves the big boy.
The big boy indeed.
Roche is pretty huge.
He is.
What is Roche supposed to be? Does that type of creature have a nomenclature?
I think he's a stone gorilla. I believe. I don't know.
He looks kind of like Diablo, honestly.
No, he does, yeah. Maybe he's the stone gorilla of Diablo's son. We'll call him...
Diablo's son, the stoned gorilla?
Yeah. Well, the stone gorilla. I don't know about stoned. I don't think he was... he could be smoking pot, man. I don't know.
I don't know, man. I've never spent any time with Roche.
Yeah, he's just sitting there alone. And chilling. And that's why he has fire at the beginning of his pits. I mean, why else? Yeah,
he angry. Yo, Puck is going for the Aghanims, actually. He's almost there, just one piece off.
They need something to change fights, and I mean, that's one of those things. If you get on five people, it definitely can.
Wow, Sunbee actually buys Aghs more than I would have thought. 9 out of 15.
This
is not a very popular item on Puck.
No, it's not. That's maybe one of those Anadota specials. We seem to be getting a lot of them lately. The Necro mid, another good one. The Kunkka, two games in a row.
Yep. Same player, same team.
God
they
bless
lose both
NA
games.
Dota.
I wonder if they'll continue.
Oh, look at the scan by NA. The
Yo,
Radiant.
That is nasty,
really
though. Mike's just coming on in. They're going to haunt right away. They've got a sentry ward down. Mike's going to walk right into it. Oh, this is so bad for Freedom. Sunbee's the one that takes the doom. Boris comes in with the Chronosphere, but his team is already in shambles. He loses his puck. Beastmaster trying to TP out. He might still live. The boat. Oh, the boat. It's just not going to do enough. It hits Doom in the face, but it's just a doom. It's already a 2-0. Boris trying to get in the tree line. He's got an Aegis. He wants to save it for another day, and he shall. Good fight for FDL. A brilliant scan to start it out to reveal the doom. They pop the haunt to see his positioning. They have a sentry ward down. Honestly, that was like the dream initiation for FDL.
That was him.
They stopped Freedom dead in their tracks and took a good fight.
That was just one of the best scans I've seen. I haven't seen a scan like literally just call out a gank you want to avoid, and they get two kills from it.
That was really sick. Yeah, this is starting to look a little bit rocky for Team Freedom. FDL are officially
Boris.
The lead. Oh, no. Boris? Oh, Boris, you sweet devil. He's silenced. He uses the Manta to get it off. CC&C in the front lines. So they'll use the Guardian Greaves to pick him up. And now Franz is here. He's got the crowd controls. Boris will fall for the first time. He's got the Aegis, so he's coming on back. He'll be able to time walk one way. Or will he? They get the Hex straight away. And Boris goes full to zero in the blink of an eye. Now Eagle on the run. They're going to suck some of his mana. Torrent into boat. Franz does not die because the Oracle's there. All right, thank you, Oracle. They'll get the tier 2 tower, and this is just going to keep on going. No void for 50. He doesn't have a buyback here, Grant.
He doesn't, and CC&C has his ult in 60 seconds. I don't even think they need it, though. Wow.
Ooh. Finger brings down the Birdman.
Yeah, he ghost sceptered himself into a finger. That's a little painful.
Yeah, that hurts. Franz uses that
Glimmer
Cape.
Oh, the Sunbee ult.
Oh, no. This is so bad for Freedom. They're going to hold on here, but they are really starting to crumble. Oh, Sunbee actually gets caught by a Hex as he gets out. Now the Primal Roar from Mike. Going to buy them some time to reset. He will get off that phase shift, but now another ult from the Spectre. It's come back off cooldown. He's going to reality in somewhere. There it is. Bisa goes deep into the base, finds Sunbee, gives him a couple of right clicks, and now Puck's dead. No buyback. 75 seconds without the Fairy Dragon. He is so much of Team Freedom's damage. This is going to be a brutal offense without it.
Whiffs on everyone, but Franz walks into it.
Yep, now Bisa walks into it as well. The boat gonna fall short. Now Boris hexed up. This is so bad for the Void. He doesn't have buyback if he dies here. They've got the stuns. They've got the crowd controls.
That's game, probably.
Yeah, this is looking like it's going to be a 2-0 for FDL. I know it's not updated here, folks, but they won game number one of this elimination series. Team Freedom about to go out to FDL. The same fate as Shazam we saw yesterday. CCNC with the ult. He's got the Exorcism and the BKB as well as the Heart of Tarrasque. This is one lane of barracks. There's a tier 2 tower still standing in the mid, so they're not going to be able to walk mid, but I think they can just walk bottom here, and they should.
I think they're just going to take the safe route and go mid, get some extra stuff maybe.
Maybe they get the tier 2.
I just want to say, if you're watching MJW, he got Q'd by the Skywrath once. It literally did 21 damage. That's how useless Skywrath is late game.
That's how poorly he scales.
Yeah, he's just terrible. I mean,
and he's even had a good game too. Like he had a great start. He's got good items, and he still can't do anything.
Yeah, that's the problem. That's why whenever Ja picked that hero, I'm like, Ja, it's not good. He's like, no, man. You know, like the early game, I'm just dominating. Like, what about later? Nah, it won't get to that. Well, okay, Ja.
Good luck hitting tier 3 towers with Skywrath.
Yeah, no, it's just rough. This is just good play from FDL. Like we said, they once again this game they were down on kills early. They always are.
Yeah.
And I mean, if they work on not going down on kills early, do you know, like, the sky's the limit for these young gentlemen.
Really is. IX Mike in so much trouble here. They know kind of where he is. They guess right. Now they'll Spectral Dagger, and he is done for. That's another freebie here for Bisa. You're absolutely right, though. FDL, they're creating this brand about them where they don't do so hot early game, but once their cores get a couple of key items, man, they just come online. And you know, watching this game, it feels like Team Freedom has just gotten progressively more tilty, right? Like they have a lot of big spells that they can combo. And that last fight, it was just, oh, here's a boat. Oh, here's a Chronosphere. Like the last two or three Chronospheres have been less than ideal from Boris. They haven't really been able to combo with much. And even the Puck, he's been getting cocky with these plays. And he's got caught a couple times now when he can't quite jump back fast enough.
Yeah, and Boris is doing the right play here, cutting the next creep wave. So he'll just have to clear one creep wave here. I think that's about the best Boris can do at this point. He is reasonably under farm now, 1-5.
I sneezed. Here we go. The high ground siege from FDL. They're going to have this exorcism in 2 seconds. The Spectre split pushing down bottom, of course, has Haunt, uses it right away. Reality's into Jubei. Gonna completely push back the Kunkka. He's just dead. The Dagon from Sunbi almost just helps Bisa kill him faster thanks to the Desolate. Tier 3 tower in the mid lane down. Still a lot of time left on this Exorcism ult. This is brutal stuff. No buyback on the Kunkka, no glyph available. I think this is the sad end for Freedom here, Grant. This is how they're gonna go out. This is their Canada Cup Season 7 legacy right here.
Yeah, it is, and this is it. Just losing to a double Kunkka pick of their own.
Yeah.
Oh, MJW,
is he going to die here? Nope, there's a false promise.
Oh, my God.
He just TPs out. Easy peasy. Stan King, not going to be quite so easy. He takes a dag onto the face, and, well, Freedom will hang on just a little bit longer. It's not even that I don't think they could stall this game out with two lanes of barracks down. It's just watching both of those lanes of barracks fall. It wasn't even really a fight. It was just FDL gets the objectives, and then Freedom picks off one or two stragglers. They just killed the two supports. I mean, I think FDL will trade their supports for lane of barracks any day.
Yeah, and they're against a Spectre going to the late game. Like, I mean, okay, you hold one more fight. The Spectre almost has Refresher now. The DP just picked up a Scythe. And it's looking rough.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. And the Arcane Rune. Go get it, CCNC.
Arcane Rune. What a rune. You know, I've spent a lot of time before Arcane Rune came out thinking about what would be another good rune. You know, what would just fit in? And I never really thought about the Arcane Rune, but I like it. I was a little skeptical when it first came out, but I've become quite a fan. I think it fits right in there, nice and tight, like next to the Haste Rune.
Yeah, I think it's one of those. It's like the Haste Rune's super good, obviously early, and then the Arcane Rune's super good, like mid late game.
Mm-hmm.
Just, and it's not like overpowering. Like, man, this game's broken.
I kind of thought it might be, honestly. Like, you see those numbers, and you're like, damn, that's a big cooldown reduction. I don't know, guys, but It's so RNG focused that it's kind of hard to play around, and it seems like teams think of it as more just a nice little bonus. It still quite isn't the same as that double damage rune outside of the Roche pit at 20 minutes.
Dude. Or that too.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous.
Oh, and look at MJW.
He walks right into it. He takes the Primal Roar straight away. Boris in the front lines. He gets hexed up now. He takes a finger. CCNC just going to try to lock him down. They can kill Boris before the Chronosphere. It's huge. They lose their Oracle, but now CCNC in the front lines. They've got the Crimson Guard on. His ult is just pulsing. Mike trying to TP home. He might live, but big damage has come out. Skywrath dies to the Spectre on the backside, and Puck will be able to walk away. Blink Dagger keeps him safe. It's another great fight for FDL. A 1-for-3. Skywrath Mage buys back. DP has her ghost for another couple seconds here. They'll at least be able to do some good damage to this Tier 3 tower. Still no glyph. Doesn't come up for another 30 seconds. MJW, M-Deep, takes the Dagon, but will be able to survive through it. Franz trying to suck back some mana. He's got a finger off cooldown, but doesn't have the mana pool for it. Sunbee getting low, hexed up, barely makes it back to the well. Another stun from the Lion. Oh, boy. They get another kill here, and there is just nothing Freedom can do. Their structures are getting taken out as they're pushed back to the well. MJW just too damn tanky. The GG is called before Mega Creeps can even come out, and that'll be it. FDL, ladies and gentlemen, this is their tournament. Canada Cup Season 7, taking down Shazam and Team Freedom in back-to-back elimination nights. That has got to feel good. Freaking
I mean,
Boris.
Yeah, freaking Boris. And like we said yesterday, the NA teams are definitely a lot more friendly than they used to be in the past. They all, so it's nice to see friends, you know, instead of enemies, bitter, bitter enemies.
Yeah, it really is. Well, that was a heated series, Grant. It was 2-0 for FDL, but pretty convincing games, both sides.
Yeah, it was. And I think the big, like you said, FDL could have been eliminated 3 games in a row. Like, I mean, three series in a row. They won that best of one loser's bracket. They're having an EG-style loser's bracket run, beating people you'd think would be favorites over them, and they're looking, like, pretty damn good.
Yeah, this puts the bracket in an interesting place now. It's Tragneel and Digital Chaos still sitting up at the winner bracket finals, and down in the loser's bracket, we're bottlenecked at Lucchini versus Evernova. Winner of that plays Complexity, and then the winner of that series versus Complexity will be now facing FDL in the lower bracket finals. So
yep, so it's I think we'll see the Lucchini Evernova pretty soon, but we might be a little stalled because the Manila Major on the other side of things.
Yeah, absolutely. There's definitely going to be a break here for Canada Cup coming up soon. So that's it for our coverage tonight, though, folks. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Ziori. He's Grant, and we had that crazy spider word.
Latrodectus.
That's it on stats tonight. So thank you for joining us here. If you enjoyed the broadcast, give us a follow on Twitter at Ziori TV and at Grand Grant. You'll want to stick around after this commercial break as well, because we are doing a loot market giveaway, folks. It's coming up after this. Take care.